Welcome to the video news of the week. There has been a long stretch of time between any updates on the Celina Cass case. Yesterday, public expectations ran high that there may be a break in the case as to what caused the death of the 11-year-old West Stewartstown girl this past summer. Yesterday afternoon, a press release was issued by the State Attorney General's office. Based on the toxicology results, Celina's death is now officially ruled a homicide. There were no arrests forthcoming, and the state is not revealing details into the cause of the death of the young girl, whose body was found in the Connecticut River a week after she went missing. Meanwhile, WMUR Television this week interviewed Celina's mother, Louisa. It was reported that Louisa has separated from her husband, Wendell, and that she and her daughter, Kayla, are now living in Vermont. You'll find more on this in the lead story in this week's Colebrook Chronicle. Perhaps the greatest story of a close encounter here in the Granite State surrounds a strange tale of Betty and Barney Hill, two New Hampshire residents who claimed that they were abducted by aliens in 1961. We spoke with Colebrook resident James D. McDonald about the Hill case, a story he has researched over the years.
50 years ago on the 19th of September, Betty and Barney Hill drove right down Route 3 out here and stopped at a restaurant in Colebrook for a cup of coffee around 10 p.m. and drove down Route 3 into history. They went public some years later and talking about what they saw on that night, and what they saw was a UFO, and they told a story about how they'd been abducted by space aliens. They were having bad dreams, so they went to see a psychiatrist or psychologist who hypnotized them and recovered this amazing memory in their subconscious. Now, as far as what they saw at the time, I've got my own theory about that. They first saw this mysterious light in the sky when they crossed the shoulder of Prospect Mountain down in Lancaster, and it got closer and closer and moved against the star field and eventually passed down the right side of their car when they passed through Franconia Notch. And that's the light on top of the lookout tower on Cannon Mountain. I said to myself, wait a minute. Maybe this was a couple of people at the end of a road trip, 1,200-mile road trip. They hadn't slept in about the last 20 hours. They were driving straight through from Niagara, New York, through Canada, and perhaps they misidentified a common object, and all the rest was based on that. Anything's possible, but the simplest explanation, I think, is the best in this case, which is a couple of well-meaning, honest, sincere people honestly and sincerely were mistaken.
McDonald also noted that the aliens in the Hills account had triangular-shaped eyes, and he theorized that they may have had a subconscious memory of seeing a large sign for the Jack-O-Lantern Resort, which they would have passed that night. The sign features a pumpkin with traditional triangular-carved eyes. The town of Lincoln is embracing the 50th anniversary of the Hill encounter. This convenience store has a large mural celebrating the alien visit. Events have been planned for the Indian Head Resort this weekend, close to the site of the alleged encounter. The gift store has been doing brisk sales of books about the incident, which is only natural, for it is here that the Hills road trip really took off.
It was the annual antique tractor and parade show in Colebrook. The event was hosted by Colebrook Feeds. A showcase of tractors of all types and sizes came down Main Street last Saturday. This past week marked the first weekend of the Coos County Corn Maze, designed by Santa's Tree Farm. Held on the property behind the Coos County Nursing Hospital, the maze offered challenges and fun for all ages. The maze continues every weekend through the end of October.
Despite the fact that the recent summer storms took a heavy toll on the access bridge leading into Loon Mountain, the annual Highland Games went on last weekend without a hitch, thanks to a temporary bridge. Thousands crossed over to take part in the annual celebration of all things Celtic, and everywhere you turned, there were bagpipes.
Yeah.
Great North Woods Committee for the Arts, in conjunction with the Sky Theater, brought the April Verch Band to town last week. The concert, featuring the popular fiddler step dancer from the Ottawa Valley, was the first professional music event held at the new Tillotson Center, which is still undergoing construction. We spoke with the band up in the balcony about their brand new CD called That's How We Run.
The last time we talked with the April was in May at the Sky Theater in Maine. The biggest development, I think, has been the release of your new CD.
It's an exciting time for us, for sure, because we've been working on the project for so long, so to have it get to this point is pretty cool.
We sort of weighed in and tried things, and sometimes those things would work, and sometimes they wouldn't work at all, and a lot of times you would take some idea and just twisted a little bit here and there, and you know, and finally we hammered out something that we all really felt good about.
And things are different on a record than they are live, too. Some things that work really well when you're listening are different when you're on stage and you know you're in front of an audience and something strikes you and you want to try something new. So, yeah, we don't set it in stone. Things continue to grow and change a little bit.
This is the first opportunity I've had to record banjo. So yeah, it was really exciting and kind of nerve-wracking for me because I've been messing around on the banjo for a long time, but I haven't considered myself a banjo player for very long.
I was listening to it the first time I listened to it, and I said, man, are you serious? This is the first time you've ever recorded a banjo on a record? Because it's blowing my mind. It's really good.
There's a mix of traditional tunes and a few covers and original stuff. But it is all kind of in that rootsy, old-timey vein. And I guess the honest answer is that's what I'm really into right now. And, you know, some people have heard it and said, so now you're an old-time player? You know, and no, not really. You know, I'll never be an old-time player, but I sure love it, and I enjoy playing it.
It's just what we were listening to the most at the time and what we were most focused on, and I think that Cody inspired a lot of that with his banjo playing. And so in a lot of ways, I mean, the record is sort of, that's in a lot of ways a centerpiece of the record, the banjo playing.
You're going to be making your first visit to the legendary Celtic Colors. How you feel about that?
We're pretty excited. You know, we've heard about it for a long time, and it'll be our debut there. And of course, I have studied fiddle music from across Canada, but you know, a lot of the music, the traditions that have come out of that area are strong in all parts and carry over. So I kind of feel like we're going to the source of a lot of it. So yeah, I'm excited.
Fall in the North Country. Expect rain and a little sun this weekend. Temps range from 57 to 71 on Friday, 55 to 73 on Saturday, and 56 to 74 on Sunday. Chronicle reporter Liz Carney sent us these videos of varsity soccer action from the past week. Groveton hosted Colebrook at their homecoming game. Later, Kanan hosted Craftsbury in these games. Thank you for watching the Video News of the Week.